I like English men. I don't know why, I just do. They've got a lot more charm.
I was always drawn to the music. It makes me feel alive and passionate and happy to be alive and joyous.
Today we're speaking with Miss Pamela DeBar. Welcome to Documators. It's such an honor to talk to you. How have people experienced you as a writer versus the perception?
If people have actually read the book, they think I'm a good writer. The people who have not read the book consider me just a horny slut. But if they read it, they realize that it's about a girl growing up in that amazing era in the perfect place and time. I realized that it was a document. I first heard the word groupie when I was with Led Zeppelin standing around in front of the Hyatt House. Someone said, oh look, she must be a groupie. At first it was just a word, but it quickly became a bad word, negative word, a jeer by people who didn't understand that we were actually muses to these men. They needed us there for inspiration just as much as we wanted to be with them.
You're the first stylist in rock and roll, basically.
No one was doing it. At the time I was doing clown eyes, gluing sequins on my face and things like that. So we helped our friends. Alice Cooper especially, we really had a lot to do with his look. Even Gene Simmons and Paul Stanley give us credit for the eye makeup, the star. All these things just pushed me on my path.
How did you have the courage to approach other well-known musicians?
We all were just hanging out back then. There was no security or anything. Met Jim Morrison very early on. He lived next door to a friend of mine. And I heard the music being played, Doors music, before the record came out, the first record. And I thought, who is hip enough to have this record? So I was stoned enough to go find out. And I walked in and just did a backbend on his rug. He was standing there going, get it on, suck my mama. These are the two phrases he said all the time. Right at that moment, Pam Corson walked in and told me to get the fuck out of her house. Being in a backbend and looking up and seeing Pam Corson looking down saying, get the fuck out of my house. I went running back up the stairs and he followed me up the stairs. She'd been throwing things at his head saying, don't you dare go up there. And they were broken Doors demos shattered all over the stairs. You know, this stuff is like, you could not even make it up.
I think I read somewhere that you had a crush on Mick Jagger.
I was so obsessed with Mick Jagger, I decided I would, for a modern art project in high school, paint what I imagined his balls would look like. I found out later I was very, very accurate.
He's very slight.
In some areas.
So you knock on Mick Jagger's door, and what the hell happened?
He opened the door naked. And instead of rushing in, I went and ran out into the night and felt so bad that I did that. I thought, wow, I could have been with Mick Jagger tonight. But I was a kid, virgin, just not sure of what to do with a naked Mick Jagger. I later found out.
One of the people you were most in love with was Jimmy Page.
Jimmy Page made every girl he was with feel like we were the only one. He has that energy where he sucks you in. He's very mysterious. He's incredibly dark, incredibly sexy because of his passion and intensity. We had this fantastically passionate affair. He liked to be in control. One night he gave me mescaline, but he didn't take any himself, just to kind of create the scenario. And man, that was one of the most amazing nights of my life. I saw, as I was orgasming, I saw huge towers of lime green sherbet coming out of me. So I was feeling and seeing these volcanoes of lime green sherbet coming out of me while I was having these orgasms and tasting it and everything. It was just, so that was pretty special. But, you know, he wound up breaking my heart.
Please tell us about your relationship with Keith Moon.
I was his LA girl, and he was always my dude when he was in town. He was very complicated. He would be considered now bipolar. So if you were with him, you had to go through those highs and lows with him. It was not easy. There was no medication at that time, so he was self-medicating with whatever he could find. And sometimes he was in an amazingly high-spirited mood. Other times he was suicidally depressed. He had been kicked out of every hotel in LA. We were going to try the Century Plaza, which is very she-she. So in order to get booked into there, he decided to be someone else. He had on a long red velvet cape, cloak to the floor with an ermine and a crown. They ushered him right in. We got the penthouse. He had me stand out on the balcony and he said, watch, I'm going to do something. I watched him hustle himself across the street to this gigantic fountain. You know, it was like a little elf. Anyway, he dumped in an entire box of Tide into the fountain and hustled back up, stood with me to watch it. And it started off like a little flounce, a little fluff, built and built till it was honestly a block high of every type of bubble, size and shape, shooting into the air like fireworks and running down each side of the street to where the cars were stopping. No one knew what was going on. To see him be Keith Moon to his fullest degree and share that with him as some count or prince, whatever he was, from some fake country. It was just the best.
Tell me about your experiences with Waylon Jennings or some fun story.
Waylon was hot. He had this pompadour, this greasy pompadour, and he wore black leather cuffs on each wrist, and he was so dangerous. But I went to see him play, so I arrived in my underwear. I wore my garters and bra and, stockings, and sat there in front of him and threw daisies at his feet, and the poor man forgot all the words, and he just could not believe this was happening. So after the show, he approached me, and I got invited to his recording session. He was recording Honky Tonk Women, the same place I met the Stones at RCA. So I was sitting around the session for a couple hours, and it was 3 a.m, and I thought, well, he's just not going for me. This is a drag. He sure seemed like he was gonna go for me. And 2 hours later, 5 a.m., he showed up at my door. When I opened the door, there was an actual man at the door. There was no androgyny here at all. It was a man, big man, with big ideas. So I was a little nervous, but I let him in, and we frolicked in the sack, and it was really wonderful. Afterwards, an afterglow, he was wandering around my little apartment looking at the pictures on my walls. It was Frank and Mick and Graham and all kinds of people with long hair. And he was scratching his head. He said, "Do you really like all this long hair and everything?" "Yes, Waylon, girls love to run their fingers through it. It's very sexy, it's what's happening." Very soon after, grew his hair and became an outlaw. And Willie grew his hair because Waylon grew his hair. And so I think I started the outlaw movement.
I agree. I agree.
His fingers on my face pushed holes through my cheeks like they were on fire and left gaping holes where more honey gushed out.
Tell me a little bit about your role as an author turned teacher.
16 years ago, I started teaching writing to mostly women. It became women's memoir. They look back at their lives and realize how incredible their lives have been. It's also cathartic. It helps them let go of guilt and shame and things I had no idea was going to happen. So it's been a very special thing.
Miss Pamela DeBars, thank you very much for sitting down with us and sharing your story.
Thank you. That was fun.
Awesome. Thank you.
Well, you've got your diamonds and you've got your pretty clothes and the chauffeur drives your car. You let everybody know, but don't play with me, 'cause you're playing with fire. Your mother, she's